It is indeed Father's Day. Ed Young, yeah. Fellowship Church, tell us what we're about.
Yeah, I'm the real Ed Young. Did you know that? No, I'm kidding. You know, Dad's name is Homer Edwin Young. That's the H. And thankfully, he did not name me Homer. Isn't that awesome? My name is Edwin Barry Young. Some people inadvertently call me Ed Young Jr. Our son is the real Ed Young Jr. But anyway, it is great to be back home at Second Baptist Houston, one of the greatest churches on the planet. Wow. But also, what's so cool about this, Dad, is we're merging our two churches, all of our campuses, all of our environments. So right now, we're seeing live in real time at Fellowship Church. We're based out of Dallas-Fort Worth. Let's give it up for Fellowship Church. Now, we have multiple locations at Fellowship Church. Let me do a big shout out to the locations. Downtown Dallas, Plano, Alaso Ranch, Grapevine, Fort Worth. In Miami, we have South Miami, Midtown Miami, Columbia, South Carolina. And we're also seen online by the magic of technology right now, everywhere. So welcome. And Dad, I'm going to throw it back to you because this is just a massive time we can gather together and talk about one of the most massive responsibilities known to man, that of being a DAD.
Absolutely, Ed. And also, all of our five campuses in Houston, we have simultaneous. We have the South Campus is working with us there. They have around 1,000 down there in attendance. We have our North Campus, and they're worshiping with us today. They have 4,000 attendants on the weekend. We have the Cypress Campus. They run 1,600 a weekend. They're worshiping with us right now in this service. And we have the Woodway Campus, 1111 service. They're worshiping with us. Did I get all five, Ben? So this is going not only here on the internet, through Fellowship Church and the Second Family all around the world. Also, we have television and radio. We don't mention that a whole lot. On five different continents and every major TV market in America, we do that week by week. So in one way, I guess we'd say, gang, this is the largest fellowship and celebration of Father's Day perhaps anywhere on the planet.
Wow.
Earth. So we're part of that. So today, I went in this service with a lot of fear. These three guys are my three sons, and Ed is married, and Ed has four children, and they're almost out of the nest. Ben has two daughters, and they're approaching to get out of the nest. Cliff has four, and they're expecting their fifth one in November. So
wow.
I'll move from being a grandfather, Joe Beth and I, and a grandmother of 10, we'll move to 11. And most of these have been granddaughters. I've had eight granddaughters after having three guys, and the daughters are much better. If you don't know that, they're a lot better than these three guys. But now I have two grandsons and another grandson on the way. So that tells us about the Young family. Today, we just wanted to meet and have sort of a family gathering. And maybe in the process, a lot of young dads who are here would say, you know, they missed it. The Youngs missed it here, but maybe they got it right here. And somehow there'd be encouragement to singles who are not yet married, who are trying to get in their repertoire, the right stuff to be a godly man. And then others who are in the process, and some grandfathers who are here to say, you know, we did the best we could, but we'd like to do it again. How many dads here will say, honest with me, I wish I had a do-over? You know, every father here would say that today. So we're going to try to lay down some very basic principles of fatherhood, what it means to be a dad, biblically speaking, and hopefully you'll pick up some personal illustrations that'll be very, very helpful to all of us. So let's begin off with a word of how we are to teach. And I think, Ben, you have that scripture for us.
I do. It's in Deuteronomy chapter number 6.
And it says,
notice, by the way, notice this Bible. Is that interesting to you? I think you've got every translation in there.
I sure do. All right, many languages as well.
It matches Ed's suit too, kind of. Look at that.
Yes. Yeah. That Dallas metallic blue.
Exactly. All right.
These words which I commanding you today shall be in your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your sons, and you shall talk of them when you sit in your house, when you walk by the way, and when you lie down, and when you rise up. So to me, that verse, that passage in Deuteronomy is saying that teaching is a 24/7 kind of thing, and you do it all the time. You're always teaching. You're always modeling. You're always living it out. And I don't think that it really means that you just sit down and pull out a Bible or your cell phone with a Bible and start preaching at your kids or to your kids, but it's more about living it out day in and day out and waiting and looking for those teachable moments that we have as parents.
Mm-hmm. How do you try to teach your kids, Cliff? What do you do?
Well, I think, first of all, people always ask me growing up what it was like to have you as a dad, what it was like to have you and mom as parents. You think, that he's a pastor, so he must always have the big Bible under his arm, have the 5:30 a.m. devotional every morning and all that stuff. And it wasn't really like that. It wasn't. I truly believe that y'all lived it so much more than you taught it. And I think that is so important in being a parent, is you have to live the gospel as well as teach it. And you have to be living it in order to be able to teach it. And so that's very true, I think, growing up.
But there has to be some intentionality.
Absolutely.
There has to be some intentionality. So what do you do to be intentional with your kids? You've got four, one on the way. You want to live it out, but how do you spell it out? How do you really?
Well, I think what Ben was saying, I think what Ben was saying was you look for those moments. And yes, there are intentional times you sit down at night before they go to bed. You read when they're younger from the, what's the children's Bible?
Holman's study.
Hurlbert.
Thank you, Hurlbert's
Bible is the one that I read from. Read stories from the Bible.
Hurlbert.
Okay.
Hurlbert.
Yeah, okay. I got you.
I'm out of that stage now.
Do you know what it actually is, and you're quizzing me? Or
no, I don't. Oh, okay. I don't. I was trying. I didn't know if you said Holman or Hurlbert or.
He said Holman. I said anyway.
Hurlbert.
I think it's Hurlbert. Anyway, but there are some times you're intentional reading stories from the Bible and Scripture, but so many times, as you go through life, as you walk through with your children, and if you're paying attention and you're listening to them, you find those specific teachable moments.
Right.
Whatever it may be.
So I know your mother would read the Bible to you, and y'all read Hurlbert's story of the Bible night after night before you went to sleep. Before kids go to sleep, that's a very important time to be there when you can. Fathers and mothers, and tuck them in and love them and kiss them. I mean, do that all the way through the very, very young ages. We take kids to children's camp, and we make a point with little kids, our counselors. They pray with them by their bed every night and pray for them. And a lot of the kids say, I've never had that before. Never had that before. So parents that's the intentionality of part of it.
I think also, too, Dad, you guys did a great job of monitoring our relationships, which I think is one of the most critical cogs in that of being a parent, especially dad, because those little ones are watching. I mean, 24/7, you're on the runway. It's like you're modeling, and those values are more caught than taught. So we see as kids how you choose friends, what you do with your friends, and then we, in fact, mirror that with our friends, but also wise parents, especially wise dads. D-A-D. Say D-A-D with me.
D-A-D.
You're divinely appointed decision makers. We have that testosterone. we have that leadership, that mantle given to us. So go our friendships. So go our kids' friendships. I think wise dads and moms, Dad, which you guys did, steer and veer their kids to the right people at the right time who will take them to the right places. And the right place is the house. Yeah, your house, But the only entity that underscores and highlights those transcendent values that should be taught in the home, because parenting is teaching and training your kids to leave, right, to individuate. The only institution that underlines those is the church. Mm. The arts, for the most part, they don't do it. Sports, they don't do it. Our educational system surely doesn't do it for the most part. Our government, they have no clue about it. Only the church. So what I would say is, and I'm 52 years old. I mean, does Dad look great? Dad's only 58 himself.
But come on.
He does. Hey, he has more energy than I do. So,
but anyway,
Dad, seriously, that the relational factor is so important. And I would just beg any dad, any single parent dad, to build his social life, to build your family's life, to orbit it around the local church. Here's the church. There's the steeple. Open the doors and see all the people. And most of the people are the kind of people, most are the kind of people that you want to relate to. So teaching relational integrity is a monstrous thing. Mm-hmm. And I'm glad you guys taught that. So to me, Cliff, you know, you see these relationships or whatever, you go, you know, you're talking to your child. You might want to think about hanging out with him, or let's, if you see something that's kind of sketchy, kind of weird, well, let's move and steer them and veer them to the right venue.
See, I remember when the two of you, so Cliff is 9 years younger than Ben. And so Cliff came along, he's almost like an only child in one
almost.
in a different venue. I remember y'all were playing with a young friend in our church. They were active at our church. You spent the night with them.
Yes.
And you saw some things there in that family. In magazines and so forth, and
that's
so you came and told us about it. Well, we didn't make anything with the family. We just cut off them playing with this particular guy, certainly not spending the night there with them. And so, man, we didn't confront the family with that, but we knew that was not the kind of guy that you'd want to play with. Yeah, they had two sons. This has been many, many years ago, and I have thought many times, I see the direction of those sons have gone.
Brilliant.
And you have to guard your young children's friendship and your older children. I could not even know you were male or female, not even know what age you are, know absolutely nothing about you, and I could not even ask your friends about you. But I would know and talk with all your friends as to who they are and what they were about. I would know everything I need to know about you.
Yes.
So friends with your kids, don't overlook that. One bad, rotten, jerky, immoral, sarcastic friend will influence your kids. You have to guide them all the way from here.
Even
all
when
the
they're
way
older
up.
Too.
Absolutely, when they're yes. older too.
You and really Dad, I think, you know, Ben and Cliff and I've talked a lot about the phenomenal relationships we've met right here in this church, specifically Second Houston and Fellowship Church. There's no friends like the friends you meet at church. That's where you meet someone to date and ultimately marry. It's the church. Guys, all the hot women are at church. Somebody help me preach.
All right, let's move to the first thing. The first thing we do is that we teach. And we teach morning. And this is the Shema. That's what the Jews did. They just had it before their kids all the time.
Then what is the Shema? You said,
the Shema, are, Shema. You have Deuteronomy chapter 5. You have the Ten Commandments.
Right.
And they're listed there for them. And they tried to build those rules and regulations in the lives of all their kids. So they would take the Shema, the Ten Commandments. They would tie it around their head, phylacteries on their arms.
Okay.
They would repeat the Shema usually two times a day. To their children when they'd wake up, to their children they'd go to bed. They had those little mezuzahs by the
yes.
doorposts they would go out, you've seen in Israel. And so they just built those God-fearing principles in their kids over and over and over again. Now that is legalism in Judaism. The wonderful thing about Christianity, we come to Christ, it's not this is what you do and this is what you don't do. That's not the Christian life. Christ in us,
yes.
and then now we have the power to surrender, and these principles are just a part of the parameters. We know why you don't steal. Don't say don't steal. Give a reason why you don't kill, why you don't commit adultery. And that is what Christ enables us
not to follow all these rules, but able to us to live them out fully in our lives. He that is within you is greater than he that is in the world. So when we stumble over these immutable laws that are here, so they sought to build this in their hearts and lives.
I wish you knew the Bible. Is that unbelievable? He's a walking, talking biblical encyclopedia. We had to do a whole series where we just come up and ask you questions, Dad.
No.
I'm serious. Was that great, the Shema? I mean, how many people knew what the Shema was? You don't raise your hand. No clue.
All right.
I know now.
Next scripture.
You went to seminary, though, didn't you?
I know. I remember Shema, but that's about it. I mean, I remember when Dad started talking. I'm like, okay, yeah, I'm with you. I got it. I feel you.
You thought it was David and Shema.
Yeah. Or, Dad, you know, I love to fish. I thought you were talking about Shimano, the fishing brand.
Read our next scripture, Cliff Forrest.
All right, this is Proverbs 22:6. It says, train up a child in the way he should go, and even when he is old, he will not depart from it. And we were talking about teaching, and then we've touched on this a little bit too, but training, when I think of training my children and training kids in the way that y'all trained us, I think of how you really got your hands dirty in training us. You didn't stand up and always look down on us and give us these instructions or say, oh, this is the way we live, and train us in that way. And there's so many moments I can remember. I was thinking, I knew we were going to talk about this, and one in particular, I think of training my family, my four kids, my wife, and then the one on the way was there as well. On the way back from Alabama, we were driving back from Beach Retreat a few days ago, and I was driving, and as I was driving the car, we drive through hard rains, and you go through all of the little cars, and I can remember, I could hear Dad's voice when he was training me, when he was teaching me how to drive, and I can remember these things. Well, I'm going by an 18-wheeler now. When you go by an 18-wheeler, don't stay right behind them. Stay in front of them. Just go on by them. Be safely. Keep the spacing. Oh, three car lengths or whatever it is in front. When you go through a rain, it's better to stop if you can't see, or stay back. Put your hazards on. Different things I was hearing. And I remember, and I really think I was about 13, and Dad had me in the driver's seat driving back from.
Yes.
I think the for all the police officers out there, I think the statute of limitations, hopefully, yes. You're not going to carry him off after this is over. But anyway, as far as you know, I was 16. And
that's funny.
Anyway, but I mean, going through, but I remember he actually let me experience that and go through and say, "Oh, try do this, do that, do this." And I remember the times that Dad would get on his knees and play. Would play with me with toys and things and basketball and get in there. And that's so important, is to live that right along with your kids and say, hey, this is how you do it, and let them try it and teach as you go. And that's what I think when I think of training.
Cliff, one of the good ways that Dad communicates and has communicated his love to us and for us, giving us opportunities and allowing us to fail, giving us decision-making rope. So, you know, it's not like he tried to do everything for us, but so often giving us chances to do something that would be a little bit out of our comfort zone or try something when we might be a little bit too young to try it, yet he was saying, okay, I love you and respect you this much. And then when you do mess up or fumble the ball, you know, he's going to be there to correct, sometimes decisively. But it's a part
talk about decisively.
I think it's a part of the uniqueness of the male that you know, divinely appointed decision maker that, you know, we need to be about.
You always made the right decisions, though, didn't you, when he did that?
Pretty much.
Okay. Yes, you did.
That's not true. No.
Yeah, talk to us about decisively. You said sometimes he'll...
Yeah, Dad's a very decisive person. Yes.
Like when you were younger.
Yeah, man,
speaking of driving.
This is speaking of driving.
Speaking of driving. But see, this definition, we're going somewhere because we're talking about teaching, that's Deuteronomy 6, that's being a parent, a dad, teaching and training your kids to leave. Teaching and training them to leave. Spouses stay, kids leave. Let me say that again. Spouses stay, kids leave. And that's Genesis chapter 2, verse 24. For this cause a man shall leave his father and mother and shall cleave to his wife. More on that in a second. Back to driving. I was 15. I had my permit, so I had to be at home with the car parked legally when the sun set, really right before the sun set. Well, I met this hot lady at church who is now my wife, Lisa. We've been married 31 years. Met her at church. At church. So, you know, I started dating her a little bit, and mom and dad allowed me, again, giving me some decision-making opportunities to drive her home, drop her off.
First time.
Yeah, first time. And then make my way home about 25 minutes away from where she lived. So I dropped her off, and for the first time, I gave her a little kiss. Now, you know Dad taught me how to kiss a girl. Did you know that? This is one of the most embarrassing things. I think I shared this. If you'll pick my book up, Sex Experiment, there's a whole chapter, Daddy Taught Me How to Kiss. That's a whole nother message. I won't bore you with that. So, first time I ever kissed Lisa, it took me, you know, a lot of guts, and I kissed her. Well, I looked at the clock. Suddenly, man, I'm way late. I'm talking about ridiculously. You're on restriction. Let's get the belt out late. So I'm driving home in my mother's station wagon. It's on a Wednesday night. Lord, I pray Dad has a meeting. I know I can get by my mom. She's easy, but Dad, it's another story. And I'm turning into our neighborhood. And I pull up our driveway. I look around. No car. Dad's not there with mom's car. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. You spared me. I walk in. My mother. Kid, where have you been? It's dark outside. I go, Mom, I kissed Lisa for the first time. I apply what Dad's been teaching me, you know? I said, where is Dad? Did he have a meeting? She goes, no, he's been out looking for you. Wah, wah, wah. All of a sudden, I hear this tire screech. He power slides into the garage, gets out. Car keys. I'm like, driver's license. I take my wallet out. Just give me the whole wallet. Your summer is mine. Ed, you're going to be grounded from now until eternity. And Cliff reminded me earlier, I think I'm still grounded. You're. He's never taken me off that grounding, Mom. But I learned a great lesson. Be on time.
I did.
And make your kisses shorter.
I learned something, too. Discipline doesn't always work. I want you to know.
Also, Ed, when Dad points, he turns his finger over like this.
Yes, let me tell you something. Yeah, Cliff.
Not like this.
Yeah, when Dad points and lowers his left eye, watch.
It's true.
Out. Get out of Dodge. Head for the hills.
But the thing about it is, they were true. In those times, there were times that Dad came on strong. Now, I know we talk about. What was it like growing up with Dad as a father?
Well, you mean Dad came on strong with Ben and I.
That's what I was going to say. No,
not
listen.
You.
Oh, yeah, Cliff.
But this is the thing.
Dr. Spock here.
And sometimes.
Cliff, isn't that right, Ben?
No question.
Two rule books.
Yeah, that's what Ben says. Oh, two no. sets of rules.
Two
Mom.
Sets of rules.
Ben and I had rules, and then Cliff.
Cliff's rules.
Relativism.
Anyway. All that to say, there were times even recently I still suffer a little bit because of having Dad preaching all the time and my friends out there and everything yeah. talking about me from the, you know. So recently he said this. He said it probably two or three times a year. He talks about when he had his kids' difference in us and how when you have three different kinds of sons, all your kids, you parent them differently according to. The way they're bent or with their personalities, you parent them differently. But
were talking about this, well, he would always say, well, Ed, we had to discipline strong. We came on strong, obviously. Have you heard? With Ed. Ben, we really had to talk to him, and he was kind of in the middle. But then, and tell me I haven't caught some flack from this, Cliff was our emotional sensitive child.
That's true. It's true, Cliff.
Anyway. I'm not the one wearing the fluorescent blue suit, though.
Whoa!
Anyway. But,
it's a personal attack.
Yeah, I mean, some people are fashion conscious, others are fashion unconscious. What do you think?
You know what? That's right. Guilty.
Let me ask you a question, all three of you a question. How, I think it's so important that you see how a son or a daughter is bent, and then you determine their bend, and it may be something out of the blue, it just staggers you. And then how do you applaud and become their cheerleader and help them with that bent? And usually it's totally unexpected. How do you discern how that child, when do you start doing that? How does that work with your sons and daughters?
I would say, Dad, once they're born, Proverbs 22:6, your baby has the bent. In other words, train up a child the way he should go. Back in the day, the beautiful thing about the Hebrew here is back in the day, they would look for a bow. They would look for the natural bend in a piece of wood, and they would take that, and that would be the bow. So they would study the wood, and then it would shoot arrows with great trajectory. You look at your kids, you see their bents. Maybe they're bent toward being more emotional. Maybe they're bent toward fashion. Maybe they're bent toward
scholarship.
Yeah. Maybe they're bent toward fishing or art collecting or whatever it is. When you applaud that, build your life around the church, you will launch them with great trajectory. They will leave, teaching and training them to leave, to individuate. And that's my part of the scripture. And the Cliff Notes, the Wikipedia basically is this. Parent out of your marriage. Those who are married, if you're a father, parent out of that. Number one, you're a husband. 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 Then you parent from that as a dad. The marriage, if you're married, now single fathers is kind of a different situation here, but if you're married, the marriage is the main thing. It's the top priority. And from there, that's the context in which you parent.
That's right.
What if your kids, though, they push back and you're trying to enact discipline and you want to be your friends? What do you do?
If your friends push back, I mean, your kids push back.
First
of all, Cliff said it earlier. Our goal as dads ain't to be their best friend, homie, their like running buddy. You know, I mean, they're parts of that. We wear those hats some. We're the parent. So when a child is under the roof of your house or apartment or whatever, whatever you say when you lead and step out, that's what they do. It's not like, do you want to go to church, honey? Where do you want to go out to eat tonight? Well, I mean, it's great to give them choices now and then, but about church, are you kidding me? Yeah. What are you smoking? We're going to church. As for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord, right? But sometimes, you know, dads, we have to become a hip-hop artist, and we have to rap.
That's right.
At our rebellious kids. I don't care if they're knee-high or tree-high. We just rap. So when your kids kind of buck up or kind of like that, you just rap. And here's a rap I wrote a while back. You ready? Are you ready? Cliff, can you? Yeah, Cliff. I don't hear a beat. I'm the parent, I'm legit. There's no use arguing, you might as well quit. You can roll your eyes and say it's not fair. You're telling God you really don't care. So do what I say all the time. Then your life will have serious rhyme. All the time. Peace of mind.
I tell you, man, we got some soul in our family. We got some soul.
He's his mother's child.
We got some soul. Somebody help me preach.
And talking about family and talking about friends, you don't want to be your child's best friend, but you want to walk around in their life. They walk around in your life, but there comes a time when the nest is empty, when you leave, as we've been talking about.
That's right.
Then hopefully they will be your friend. They'll come back to a mom and dad now and share with them almost as peers, yet as someone they can listen to, someone can help them, and we confide in them when we're in an SOS, and they confide in us. That's your goal when they leave. Right. You have that deep relationship.
Ironically,
that makes a difference.
And ironically, a lot of times it's because you were not trying to be their best friends, because you gave them the right kind of instruction, because you all that,
That's right. That
we end up going to you and saying, hey, I need some advice on this. I want to, hey, let's go hang out, play golf, whatever. That's ironic, maybe.
Let me ask y'all a question that sort of begins to sum up what we're talking about. Which one of you broke that window in Wesley's house? Nah, I'm teasing. It was Hey, I'll tell you something. When Ed and Ben were coming up, Batman and Robin were big everywhere. Now, to show you, we can anticipate how they're bent. Ed did not like Batman's uniform. It didn't have any style. So Ed was Robin. And Joe Beth made costumes for him. Here is Robin in a Robin outfit. Here is Ben, much smaller, in the Batman outfit, because Ed liked the color of Robin. Hey, there's a picture of it. I didn't know we had
it. That's shocking, shocking. Wow. Hey, look, Ed, Sam, he's still wearing the shoes.
Man.
That's good. Actually, I don't think you had the shoes then. You finally got them. That's the whole deal.
Well, it's amazing. I want to apologize for my family. Now, one thing about our home, we have a lot of fun. I think that's important. Home ought to be a place where you go and you celebrate and you have fun. And to do that at this stage in life, it means along the way that you failed a lot and said, I'm sorry, I blew it, I made a mistake. And along the way, you come back and we recall all these memories. And memories are a very important thing, ladies and gentlemen. Build good memories of love and fun and fellowship and laughter. Time when you all cried together when things bottomed out. Time in which you all sacrificed and we couldn't do things that others could do financially or even in the area of recreation in life. But I know delayed gratification is something we all need to learn. We continue to learn it. So I would say to all of our kids and parents, teach your kids about delayed gratification in every area of life. They study. Others are going out, but they study at this time. Others are having sex, but this is not who we are. That's not our family. Others are on drugs. This is not who we are. We back up. And then they will grow and mature, and who knows, the day may come when they'll rise up and look at some of us dads and moms and even call us blessed. Blessed. That's our goal, isn't it? We teach, we train, they leave, they come back, and we celebrate those memories. We're grateful for the grace of God that's given us forgiveness when we blew it so many, many times. And that's what we're about as a family of faith. I'm proud of my boys. Parents, there's one thing you must not forget, and you've heard it over and over, but it's really, really true. I always said if my guys turned out to be delinquents, and I almost made it, it's because they spent a lot of time with their dad. Kids spell love. T-I-M-E, T-I-M-E, T-I-M-E. And you have to, when you're with them, be totally with them. Be completely with them. I remember once when Ben was very small. He remembers it too. I don't know how he was. He was 4 or 5 years of age, and I was reading the newspapers in the morning, and he said, Daddy, I want to talk to you. I said, okay, son, what do you want? I want to talk to you. I said, okay, I'm reading the paper. And he came just crashing through that paper, right in my lap. He said, I want to see your eyes. I'll never forget that. Parents, when you talk to your kids, see their eyes. Let them know that right there, they're the most important individuals on earth. How many times, Joe Beth and I, on a Saturday night, the only day I used to work was on Sunday. Now I work a little on Saturday. But on Saturday night, man, you're ready to preach. You need to go to sleep. You got a full schedule tomorrow. That's the big day. Inevitably, on Saturday night, one of these three guys would come in, 10:30, 11 o'clock. We're going to bed. And they'd begin to tell us something about their life. And they would go on and on and on and on and on. And I remember clear as yesterday, Joby, I said, Joe Beth, man, we've got to tell them to go to sleep. And she gave very wise motherly advice. She said, Edwin, when they want to talk, whatever it is, we have to learn to listen. Verbatim. And that's what we need to learn, parents. When your kids want to talk, and I would say to my three sons, when your kids want to talk, it's not the right time. They don't schedule it. That's when we have to listen. I want to do something now, a little different. I want every father to stand. Would every dad here stand? Grandfather, stand. Every dad, stand up. Miss something. Miss something. And I want us, all of us, to pray for these fathers. Some of them are still in the fathering business 24/7. The kids are at home. Some of us have graduated and the kids have left, but we're still in the parenting business. And then some of us have gone on and graduated to the great fathering business, and that's the best business of all. I can tell you that without any question at all. Right, dads? You ever get there, you've arrived. But let's pray for these men. In the 21st century, the greatest thing America needs is not somebody elected to all the multiplicity of political offices. We don't need great affluency to save America. The best thing that would save America if every father would seek to become a man of God and influence their family, where they work and what they do for the Lord Jesus Christ, that would bring revival and renewal to our land like nothing else on the planet. So let's pray for these men who are standing. Would you pray with me? Our Heavenly Father, all of us who are standing, fathers, we've never got over the miracle of the birth of these sons and daughters. It's beyond anything we can imagine that you use us with our wives to bring life into the world, an eternal soul, a life that's made in your image, a life that will live forever. Oh, Lord, our God, may we use the time you give us on this earth to seek by your grace to build the right stuff in these sons and daughters by teaching, by training, and then by seeing them leave and graduate from the family and go out and make a life that is pleasing to you, a life that carries on a tradition of a Christian home, a Christian church, a Christian family. Lord, bless these men. Forgive us when we fail so many times and lift us up so that we once again may be men of God in a broken culture. This is our prayer for all of us in Jesus' name. You may be seated, gentlemen, and have a blessed Father's Day.